better able to handle the challenges that we face in our communities. I couple that with some pretty strong career and slash personal goals. So I've always focused on, I like to be a learner. I always like to be learning. So one of my career goals and personal goals is that in each role that I take, that there's always something that I can offer, but a lot to be learned. I'm not the person who will settle for something that I'm not passionate about. So finding, and yes, we'll go into detail about finding passion in finance or quality improvement, but just never settling for something that you're not passionate to and never getting stuck. So I'm of the belief that your career is your own, and it is up to you to personally guide yourself through your career path and to reach your career goals. So again, that means always seeking jobs where there are new skills that can be provided or acquired, and you can build on what you've done, recognizing that change is inevitable, and being open and flexible is very important. So how did I get from Georgetown to today? Currently, the company I work for, Kimbia, who provides online fundraising, campaign support, and software to nonprofits. This is just a little bit of a career timeline for me. I started out of college at General Electric and spent 4.5 years there, 4 years there, in a variety of roles from finance. So coming out of college as a finance major, looking for a role where I could learn or use the skills I learned and apply them in an environment that was exciting, fast-paced, and challenging. I took a position with GE's financial management training program. So again, that learning aspect, building that in, working for a very large corporation. That being said, I worked for a very small business unit within GE, but for a very large corporation, which came with a lot of autonomy, a lot of pressure, stress, and a real good place to learn and get up to speed on a number of things. From there, I transitioned into a role of Six Sigma, which is their quality improvement program. Really got interested when I did that. I was still in the finance department with how people adapted to change and change being an important part of your career and being able to handle that and deal with that and adapt to that. I jumped from there to graduate school. We were living in Chicago, and really thought that I wanted to spend time post grad school doing management consulting. Did some work there, but you'll see that I put on here that the next career timeline was that. We took an opportunity to relocate, my husband and I, to San Diego, which is where he's from. And at that point, I had acquired a number of skills working for large corporations, having learned more in graduate school, but turned down offers to do what I thought I wanted to do, to sort of step back. And as that opportunity presented, that time to step back and really find something that I was passionate about, and I kept coming back to wanting to work for a nonprofit. So from there, I found a job at the San Diego Foundation. I don't know. San Diego Foundation is a community foundation, which means they operate very much like a business in the one sense that they are a charitable bank. The other piece of it is that they do a lot of grant-making program and support local organizations. And I had an opportunity to take the skills I had learned in managerial and organizational behavior and strategy and business school, and certainly some of the cornerstones or building blocks I learned at GE, and take a role where I could help provide organizational effectiveness training. So everything from strategic planning, financial management, to fundraising, with over 200 local organizations. So it gave me a chance to work for a nonprofit, but then also be in a position to provide strategy consulting for organizations and fundraising consulting to organizations, to nonprofit organizations. Then I had we relocated to Washington, D.C. in 2010. And again, I took a chance to evaluate where I was and what was important to me. I did independent consulting for approximately a year, largely through networking, worked for GuideStar, supported the San Diego Foundation from D.C., and then joined Kimbia in the fall of 2011. So I've taken time, and what I'll go over is I've taken time, and we're looking at those relocation times, and even acting as an independent consultant to sort of find my way from one industry to another, or one sector to another. Again, I think it's important to go back to what I talked to you about career goals and personal goals. When I initially left the for-profit industry, it was really an opportunity with relocation, the ability to utilize skills in a new sector, the flexible work arrangement. So I found that I could work, 4 days in the office. I could have more reasonable work hours. I could help others, and I could and make my new community a stronger one. So when I was, the things that I loved about working for a for-profit company were the new challenges. Again, a ton of opportunity to learn and grow, but I had felt sort of stuck in a career where it was all about the bottom line and not necessarily about helping others. Then I looked at it, sort of the next opportunity, again, in the nonprofit. I think that when you're thinking about a nonprofit career and looking at nonprofit and versus for-profit, one of the things to think about is skill development and things that that you can learn from both. These were sort of the major skills or learning moments for me. The nonprofit world and finding a career there, I was dealing with multiple stakeholders with different objectives. So it was very easy in the for-profit world to measure, because there was a bottom line. It was operating margin or net income at GE, but there was sort of one stakeholder, which was the shareholder. In the nonprofit world, it's very, very different. So you're dealing with board members, volunteers, staff, and then community, so the community needs. And in my case, working at a community foundation, we were even one level more removed from working directly with to help solve problems in the community, because we were providing funding to the organizations who were working with the people who needed services. I also learned that there is so much need and not enough resources. A lot of what brings people to the nonprofit sector is they're passionate about a particular cause or particular need. And it's really important to evaluate what other resources that are available. Additionally, I learned how to evaluate nonprofits and choose investments wisely. So you do have the opportunity in the nonprofit sector to really learn and learn a lot about nonprofits and be able to make evaluations and investments wisely. I also learned a lot of patience. The nonprofit sector, because of the first one, dealing with multiple sectors, decision making, especially in the larger organizations, is much slower. The pace of work was much slower. There's a lot of thought and energy that goes into ensuring that the right decisions are made and the right investments are made. And so having patience and understanding that decisions that may take a week elsewhere may take a couple months just because of all of the different levels of buy-in and stakeholders that need to be considered. That leads into sort of what I've learned. So while I was very passionate about the nonprofit sector and helping and supporting them, the pace of change was much faster in the for-profit sector. So the ability to make change and make an impact, and even in a very large corporation like General Electric, was much faster than in the nonprofit sector. But the decision-making process was very different. So decision-making is typically made by consensus in the nonprofit sector versus, and so that requires a lot more time that goes to the first one. One of the most frustrating things was balancing who pays for goods and services and who uses them, because they can be very different. So you have two different, you have the constituents of the donors who are typically paying for services or resources for individuals who can't afford them. And so there are challenges in terms of finances because individuals can't pay for the services that they need, and you have to find others. The pay scale is significantly less. So I would say if you're following your passion, you also have to be willing to take some risks. One of the things that I did when I left business school was that when I took the job at the San Diego Foundation, I knew that while I had a lot to offer, I had a lot to learn. And so I took a significant pay cut to really take advantage of the learning opportunity. So I said it was very much about investing in education still in myself to learn a lot more and be able to provide better support to organizations in the community. And that typically nonprofit organizations are doing more with less resources. As I mentioned to Sarah before we started this call, is that you have to be creative. You may not have all of the different systems that you're used to, whether or not you like them or not, in place. But you don't. So you have to be able to be creative and do more with less. So through my transition from for-profit to nonprofit and back in sort of a blended career, I had sort of three different things in terms of career, what I call reflection points. We have been, my husband and I have been through two major relocations. One from Chicago to San Diego, and second from San Diego to Washington, D.C. So in 5 years, we made two major moves. Before that, I took a very big leap going, again, from a career where I was working my way up within GE, and took a really a step back and made an investment in going to business school and using that as an opportunity to learn some frameworks, evaluate where I wanted to be. And then the third one being, those are my two little girls. Taking some, I call them my biggest career reflection points, because they've really helped me find balance and really forced me to evaluate career options based on, you know, the impact to my family. So the impact, both positive and negative, and the and all of the benefits to our family. That gets to my current role. I think I have the best of both worlds. So I work for a company called Kimbia, and I really found my way to this because I was looking for a part-time-ish flexible position. I was very interested in, when you're talking about fundraising drivers for nonprofits, the tremendous growth opportunity of donations online, so having people be able to give via the web and via campaigns that, you know, create community and support local organizations. I was looking for one that bridged the for-profit and the nonprofit sector, so that I was able to still work with, in my case, community foundations and large nonprofits, so I could work in the nonprofit sector, but work for a for-profit company, and in this case, a very entrepreneurial one, a startup organization, which gives me the pace, the flexibility, the ability to grow the company I work for significantly, and learn a ton about, again, a new area or newish area for me, which would be online fundraising. So I had taken what I had learned in terms of I'm able to apply the skills I learned in working for for-profit in terms of bottom line revenue and growth strategies, and I'm able to use that sector-specific expertise, which is working with community foundations and understanding donor motivation, nonprofit organizations, and communications, and again, have a part-time-ish and flexible job. So it's really an opportunity to bridge these two sectors, to apply and learn new skills, and continue to give back to nonprofit organizations and do something that I'm passionate about. Sarah, I thought I'd stop here and see if there's any questions before going on.
We actually do not have any questions at this time. If anyone wants to type in anything quickly, then let us know.
Okay.
But it looks like we're all set.
Great.
Okay.
So this is where I often get questions is, how did you sort of manage to find something that you're passionate about, that bridges both worlds, that you can leverage, you know, all of the different things that you've learned throughout your career so far, and do something that you're really, really passionate about? Again, I think the first thing is a little bit of luck, so which goes in with the second, a lot of networking. My belief is that you find opportunities like this aren't found and job postings. They're found through networking and utilizing resources that are available to you. So whether they be an in-law, somebody you've worked with, someone you've gone to school with, or whatever, but constantly being open and to these opportunities. The nonprofit sector is no different than the for-profit sector in that it really does help to know people and to be able to make connections. And so it's a really important skill to focus on. I could say that the third thing is a real focus on and only doing what makes me happy. So not taking, I turned down jobs. I took time off. I really took an opportunity to decide what I wanted to do and what I wanted to be when I grew up, because I think it's very important that you never settle and you really focus on what makes you happy. To that end, having a very supportive partner, in my case, my husband, to be able to help provide support and give me that flexibility as an ability to learn has been very advantageous. And then lastly, taking advantage of reflection points. So where you are today, where you want to be, and those changes that life brings, whether it be relocation, kids, school, job loss, whatever it might be, taking advantage of those times to really find something. If you're looking to break into and really learn about the nonprofit sector and see if it's a good opportunity for you, one of the ways I learned a lot at first was through volunteer work. So being an active member of your community and engaging with an organization, trying to get on a board and doing volunteer work to sort of see what the opportunities are and see if that's a fit for you. Interviewing with local leaders. So I spent a lot of time trying to meet and network with when I was trying to break into the industry, foundation leaders and larger nonprofit leaders, knowing what type of organization you're passionate or what types of organizations you're passionate about. So a foundation, like a community foundation, is a great asset. They work with all different types of organizations and can help make connections to people that that you may be interested in and learning from, or organizations who need help or support. In my case, I was particularly passionate, and I am particularly passionate about community foundations because of their local expertise, the number of nonprofits that they do support through their programs, the evaluation and the opportunity to present opportunities to donors and learn from that. I think this is my the last slide, which is about following your passion and never settle. Knowing your market, sector, or field expertise is really important. Oops. If you're looking for a flexible job. So again, back to that finding balance. In my case, it was really knowing the community foundation sector was very valuable to a number of different organizations, and having somebody to be able to have that specific expertise was why Kimbia hired me. They were looking for someone who understood the market, and therefore I could put together a plan that was flexible for me. Always be networking. Don't settle for the first thing if you don't have to. And lastly, the thing I've learned, if you want to be flexible, if you want flexibility, be flexible yourself. So you have to be able to be flexible to adapt to a job that maybe on paper is 20 hours, but in reality is 40 hours. You have to be able to adapt to changing needs and demands of work, of family, and of life. You have to be able to, change when needed. With that, I have time for questions.
All right, great. We have quite a few. So everyone, anyone else has a question, please take a moment and enter it in now. But we'll just start off with these. Do you recommend starting in for-profit work before nonprofit work?
Great question. I think if you want to find a blended career, my opinion is yes. I think there's a lot to be. I think in the for-profit world, you're going to learn a lot of really important skills and basic principles of business, which will very much help support a nonprofit career. I think that which really helped me because it allowed you to question and push back and provide a lot of value when you're working with nonprofits. Nonprofits are businesses as well. I mean, it's a tax status, but they operate very differently. And so understanding some basic principles that you can bring in from the for-profit world to apply to nonprofit world would be, in my opinion, very valuable to go that way.
Okay. And do you have any recommendations on how to effectively network specific member organizations or professional organizations to join or anything like that?
Yes. So there are, so depending on, this would be one that's like, there's a couple. So one, if you're looking in the nonprofit sector, one of the ones that I find is very interesting and a place to learn a lot because it has people from sort of the foundation world, from the nonprofit world, working for a small or a nonprofit or even a large nonprofit and some consultants is the Young Nonprofits Professional Network. The name, despite the title, it's pretty much open to everyone, and they tend to have them in all different communities. That's for sort of a nonprofit networking. I've really relied on both my graduate and certainly undergraduate alumni networking opportunities, and so those are great resources for people, and hopefully everyone's using those. I'm trying to think, depending on if you're interested in a particular type of nonprofit, there are also associations of nonprofits. There are foundation grant maker bodies, and I'm happy to, if you have some specific questions, we could follow up afterwards with my email, and I'm happy to chat about some of the resources that I think are extremely valuable that may be in your community.
Okay. All right, and this is a great question, Lori. Do you feel that graduate school was necessary to the transition, or do you feel like you could have made the transition straight from your previous career?
Great question.
Age-old question to grad school.
I know,
I know.
I'll say that I don't think, despite making a huge investment, I learned a ton in graduate school, and it was certainly an experience that I think, is a wonderful opportunity for everyone. I say that with a caveat that I think it makes it easier to transition because you've already sort of moved once to do it, but that it's not required. I mean, I did not need to have an MBA to work for a foundation or to transition into the nonprofit sector. Like I said, I think I was able to leverage what I learned there. I focused a lot on that managerial and organizational behavior, and because you spend so much time trying to move your organization and you're dealing with multiple stakeholders, I learned a lot of strategy around how to do that I might not have known beforehand, but it's definitely not, it's not required.
Okay. And What are your biggest lessons learned, the do's and don'ts, when transitioning into the nonprofit world?
Like just do's and don'ts. Transitioning.
I guess if
What
there
I'd
was anything
say,
you wish someone had told you before you went in.
I made a lot of missteps by speaking about how much I wanted to leverage all of the skills I learned and making it seem like I knew more than them. In terms of saying I wanted to apply my business background in the nonprofit sector. I mean, that's the reality is you always want to apply the skills you've learned to that. There's a lot of, so that would be one. I would say that there's not understanding the complexities of those different stakeholders beforehand. And so hence it led to some frustration and awkward moments not realizing that you couldn't always make all the decisions yourself. Those would be sort of the two lessons learned. So the first being, being humble because it's a new sector and there's lots of learning. So not, and that is something that would apply to any, moving from any job to another job. And then taking time to learn sort of the intricacy of the various different stakeholders and how you have to engage them to get things done.
Okay. And how have your moves and flexible hours affected the pay scale you have encountered? Does that make a difference? Is it a give and take?
Well, let's see. My move from the for-profit to the nonprofit sector initially after grad school, I took, well, from entering grad school to exiting, so my salary going in to when I exited, not including the salary I made when I was doing consulting while I was there, I took a 50% pay cut. I was able to bring it up by the end of my time so that it was more, so after 6 years working at a community foundation that it was more than what I made. I worked 32, I was in the office 32 hours a week when I was, had more flexible time. Transitioning that back into the for-profit, I more than doubled what I make. So it, but it was because I had that expertise that I had gained. So I call that, I mean, still as part of my time, it's very much, I've always, when you're making it, and it was more of an investment, my time at the San Diego Foundation in terms of the learning that I got working with foundations and for, or working for a foundation and working with nonprofit organizations. So that now I have a job where, I technically work 28 hours a week and make double what I made working less hours and more time. So, or more hours. Sorry. I work less hours now. Before I worked more hours.
Wow.
Yeah, so, but it, I mean, it's been over the course of eight, that's like eight, 10 years.
Okay, and can you comment a bit more on the field of social entrepreneurship and how it fits with the more traditional nonprofits?
So social entrepreneurship is, I would say it's probably not my area of expertise. I mean, I do what I do. I work for a for-profit entrepreneurial company now. It certainly has a social purpose by helping organizations, but by every stretch, by no means is it a nonprofit and, or a social enterprise. I have worked with, when I was working at the foundation, a number of organizations who either had a social enterprise component to theirs, so a business unit that provided funding to support their core mission. So I have worked with them, but it's probably not my area of expertise. That's again something where I'm happy to kind of connect them to somebody I know who knows that better than me.
And I will say we did a webinar on social entrepreneurship in January. So if you check out our archives, that might provide you with a good overview. So this next question, this person has two young daughters as well and found her dream job at a global public health organization, but due to high hours and just not enough pay, she had to turn it down and is back in the private sector. So how do you suggest she stays in touch with her passion while continuing to work in the private sector until her life allows her to go back to what she found to be more interesting?
I'm sorry to hear that. that's a hard thing. I think that, I have to say that I'm very lucky because the CEO of the company I work for, Kimbia, has a wife who works part-time, so he saw in me what he saw in his wife in terms of the ability to, like, to do that. When I've said part-time-ish, I should say that I probably work more full-time than, or I work full, I probably do work full-time, but it's on my schedule, so it still feels like part-time. And so having that flexibility, I have to say that in terms of keeping connected to that world, I would see if there's opportunities to still sort of stay connected to that organization or other organizations from a volunteer perspective, knowing that takes time. So that kind of helps, but anything where, or think about, ask, you know, again, it takes time, but doing a project for that organization. Again, I had the flexibility to take, I actually consulted to Kimbia before I took a full-time job, mostly because I told them I didn't want to take a job where I didn't know them and they didn't know me, because I wanted to make sure that it was really part-time. I think it's a huge challenge. I think it's finding the right fit. So with the organization and you, and if you have the chance to take a little bit of time off and do something, or to add in a little bit more time and do a project for an organization, a way for them to sort of gain an understanding of who you are and what you can provide them. I think once you're more of a known quantity, it's easier for you to ask for more flexible hours and time.
And you already said a little bit, Lori, about that your family was supportive of your decision, because we have someone here who is worried about that. Her family is concerned about the financial success if she goes into the nonprofit world, specifically with museums.
And family can be multiple levels. I have to say, I get a lot, my husband was very supportive. Clearly, my mother and was extremely excited that I could find something that where I could work and do some of the work that she really liked doing, like working for or working with organizations and actually get paid for it. And so that's been very helpful in that. And they provide a lot of support. But I do think it's something that I call it the happiness factor. So if you're doing something that you love, you tend to be more happy, and then you're going to be a better contributor to the family and to, you know, again, whoever it is in the family that you're working with. And so being, you know, not doing what you want to just because you're worried about someone not thinking it's a good idea probably is a hard place to be in, but that if you focus on making yourself happy, again, and doing what you're passionate about, I think there's other opportunities out there. So working for, you know, I certainly, like I said, took a significant step back in terms of A, responsibility, and B, pay when I transitioned, but, you know, I now look on it, and it was always, you know, thought of as this was, you know, yet another investment in something that would get us to, you know, get my family to a place where I could have the flexibility that we needed and a job that I was passionate about.
Okay. And for someone in the nonprofit world who might be interested in going in the opposite direction into the for-profit sector, do you have any recommendations?
Um, This might be a case where graduate school might be a sort of, if you haven't done that before, a good opportunity. I think looking for like industry or like type organization, for-profit organizations. You're with an arts organization, finding something that's creative for, I mean, if that's what you're passionate about, is good. I think finding an organization that, a for-profit company that works with a nonprofit organization, or finding a foundation that funds certain types, you know, the type of organization you're coming from. So kind of taking a foundation still being a nonprofit, but being more like a for-profit than a nonprofit, or some interesting, because you're, again, going to be able to utilize that expertise and put it and learn some new skills.
Okay. And we did have a follow-up question on the grad school. This person's wondering less about the substantive skills that you learned in graduate school, and more whether you felt like it was necessary to the story you were telling prospective employers about your move to the nonprofit world.
Can you say that one more time?
Sorry, so was graduate school less about the skills but more essential to the story you were trying to shape about your move from the for-profit environment to the nonprofit environment?
Oh, okay. Do you need to do graduate school to be able to do that?
Mm-hmm, exactly.
Again, I don't think you needed to have graduate school. It certainly helped to have some reason. I mean, in my case, if it hadn't been graduate school, it was that we were relocating. So there was a story there. I mean, having a story for why you want to do it is always important. Having a reason, graduate school doesn't have to be that. So a move doesn't have to be that. It just has to be something that you're committed to. I think if either of those things hadn't happened, I probably still would have figured out how to transition out of what I was doing and find something that was interesting. Certainly, they gave me, they helped having a, you know, as part of the story. But if you're passionate about working, and transitioning from one to another, I think that's the story you need to tell.
And is there any advice you would give to someone who's a volunteer or a board member for a non-for-profit who also works full-time in the banking or finance world? So since they're not in that world on a day-to-day basis, is there any advice you would give to them?
Sure. I love board members and volunteers.
We do. Yeah.
I mean, they're different. I think if I were them and I wanted to really, really learn, because it's one thing to, I think the best board members are ones who know the organization. And so taking a day and like shadowing your executive director or somebody on your program team to see what's really, really going on in the organization will make you much more knowledgeable. Board members, if you're a board member of an organization, you're the fiscal, you know, fiscally responsible from a governance perspective for what goes on in your organization as well as all the programs. And so I think sometimes you don't have insight into what's really going on because it's hard too if you're not there on a day-to-day basis. So I highly encourage you to take up whatever opportunities to actually really participate, again, whether it be shadowing or not. I know that sometimes that can be hard because of your roles and your responsibilities. But the biggest thing I think you can ask and add in terms of board meetings is that and this is just something is really adding that the analytic skills in terms of really understanding the sources of revenue and the sources of costs. So how much it actually costs to run a program in your organization, because that's going to help build the case for funds, you know, and fundraising with major donors, et cetera. And then, of course, every board member, I think, should give to the organizations they support. That's just that's a little plug for nonprofits.
Okay. And do you happen to have any examples of people that switch to the nonprofit world for the wrong reason? People end up overestimating any specific for-profit skills or underestimate any specific nonprofit challenges.
Right.
Which I know we
I don't have any I don't have a specific person that I could tell you, but I can tell you that a lot of times people think, oh, well, it will be easier in the nonprofit sector than it is in the for-profit sector. Or they do it because they don't understand that. I mean, I think it's just as challenging, if not as challenging, working in the nonprofit sector and the for-profit, because it just the business rules. There's some great reading out there on this topic in terms of understanding the differences. One of my favorite resources is the Nonprofit Finance Fund and a lot of what they talk about, because they talk about the economic drivers of business or of nonprofits versus businesses. And then I think it was Jim Collins had a book, The Good to Great, but for the social sector, which is also really, really interesting. And then there's some other research out there called Money for Good. So all of those things I think could provide you with some more concrete examples of it. But I think that there's a lot of times people who take second career roles in the nonprofit sector because they think like that now's my time to give back, but really underestimate the amount of time and energy and sort of the differences between the two.
Okay. All right. Well, we are actually got through all of our questions, so we can
Great.
End a few minutes early unless anyone has anything else. But Lori, thank you so much. And this
sure.
is definitely a conversation we will continue hopefully on down the line, because I think there's so much to say about the differences between going into the two sectors.
Yeah,
so thank you
sure.
very much for your time today.
All right, thank you.
All right, and everyone, please tune in. We're doing a webinar next week on authentic leadership. And on next Thursday, we will have one of the Jesuits on campus speaking about working in faith, hope, and love. So that's one of our spirituality webinars. And I have sent out the ACS webinar archive to everyone in the chat box, and also a brief survey if you don't mind taking that. Everyone have a good day, and hopefully talk to you soon. Bye.